in the favor of God here at St. Peter's. And I've been teaching on Wednesday night about the favor of God for the last month or so, but you haven't been there on Wednesday, so I thought I'd bring a taste of it to you this morning. Amen. And I won't finish this lesson this morning. Wednesday night going to be, it's actually going to be another part to this. I'm going to talk to you this morning on the set time of God's favor has come. But I know I can't finish it this morning, but I will pick it up Wednesday night. And if you ain't got anything to do on Wednesday night, I think it would be to your advantage to come to Bible study. You only give God 2 days a week, Sundays and Wednesdays. And you're in the world all week. You out there in the marketplace all week. You ought to make some sacrifices for God's house. Amen. You know, I tell everybody, time is nothing but a matter of interest. You find time to do what's really in your heart. Don't put God in the back burner. Tell your neighbor, don't put God in the back burner. Make the things of God a priority. And when you make the things of God a priority, you're destined for greatness. And that's the one thing God looks for, put him first. God should be first in everything. You should make Sunday morning a priority to be in church. And if you can't make it, then you can stream. But there's nothing like being there, sitting and hearing under the anointing. And then you ought to make Wednesday night a priority, or either Wednesday morning. Say, God, I'm going to make the things of God a priority. That's what God looks for. He must have preeminence in everything. And some of you have, but I want to talk to the rest of those guys that's trying to make a decision. Amen. Again, Father, we look to you in everything. And we praise you and we thank you in Jesus' name. You know, the Bible says this in Psalms 5:11. Let all those who put their trust in God rejoice. Then he said, let them shout for joy. Why should we rejoice and shout for joy? He said, because God defends us. Amen. Hey, guys, you got to learn that God defendeth you. Amen. And then he said, let them that love their name rejoice in thee. Man, you ought to be so full of the joy of the Lord that the world get mad at you. Because you're always smiling. Yeah. Tell your neighbor, inform your face that God is on your side. Because the Bible says everyone who put their trust in God should be rejoicing. Why do we rejoice? We rejoice in the fact that no weapon that's formed against us will prosper. And every tongue that rises against us in judgment. There should be such a joy in your house, in your life, in the church, that the people of the world get mad because we're not sad. Because we don't have a sad story. Because God is on our side. See, you would, if I didn't know who was on my side, I would get sad. But the Bible said, let all of those who put their trust in thee rejoice. And he said, let them even shout for joy. Every now and then you need to inform your face that you are saved. God is on your side. Then he says in verse number 12, he says, for the Lord will bless the righteous with favor. He will compass you about with favor. We are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. We have favor with God because the scriptures say God will bless the righteous with favor. And when you got saved, you became his righteousness through Jesus Christ. And you know, we quote this one all the time in Psalms 35:27. He says, let them all shout for joy and be glad. That favor my righteous cause. Then he said, let them say continually, let the Lord be magnified who has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant. So if you're not rejoicing, that means you don't know whose side is you on. Because the Bible said, let all of those who shout for joy and be glad who favors his righteous cause. We favor his righteous cause. We're involved in his righteous cause. We promote his righteous cause. We are walking in his righteous cause. We are doers of what he said. So we can rejoice. Amen? Amen. Now, guys, I got a word for you this morning from God. Listen, and I'll finish it up Wednesday. No, I won't finish Wednesday, but I pick it up again Wednesday night. Notice there on the screen, this is God talking to you personally. Thou shalt arise and have mercy upon Zion. Wow. For the time to favor her, yay, the set time is come. I'm going to really dig into this Wednesday night. Time won't permit me to deal with this like I want to this morning, but the set time of God's favor, the Bible says, is come. So notice there in verse number 14, for the servants take pleasure in her stones and favor the dust thereof. Verse 15, so the heathens, the people of the world, shall fear the name of the Lord. And all the kings, we are those kings that he's speaking about, of the earth, their glory, because Revelation 1, 5, and 6 say, he's made us kings and priests unto the Lord here in the earth. And then notice in verse number 16, when the Lord shall build up Zion, verse 16, he shall appear, verse 16, when the Lord shall build up Zion, he shall appear, verse 6, okay. When the Lord shall build up Zion, he shall appear. So I pulled three things out of there. I want to whet your appetite with this morning. Notice that first bullet there, the time of his favor has come. I'm going to deal with this Wednesday night, God's time, and I don't have time. I started to try to cover it this morning, but I only have such a short time to communicate to you the mind of God. But timing is important in the things of God. In the fullness of time, God sent forth his son. Timing is the key. You got to know that. And to this ministry here, and to those of you that have walked this thing out that I'm communicating, the set time of God's favor has come. You got to know that you are his righteous. And he said, the righteous shall shout for joy and be glad. If you're not rejoicing, you don't know who's on your side. The time for you to walk in the favor of God is now. Because God is a now God. Tell your neighbor, God is a now God. Now are we the sons of God. Now are we the righteous of God. Now are we the prosperity. Now are we walking in the blessings of God. Amen. And then notice that second bullet he stated there. He said, the nations of the people shall fear the name of the Lord. When the world see, listen to me, St. Peter's, where this church is walking in the favor of God. I am, you are, we are walking in the favor of God. When our friends and when the world see the favor of God upon us, even your relatives and even your enemies, they're going to acknowledge that God is on their side. They're going to acknowledge there's no way for them to do what they are doing or for them to walk in what they're walking in except the favor of God. Tell you something else about favor. Favor is influence. God will give you influence in places that you never dreamed of. God will give you influence with people that you never thought of. When the favor of God is upon you, you have influence in every area that you walk in. On the job, you have influence. In the neighborhood, you have influence. Your occupation, you have the influence of God, because that's what favor does. It brings you influence with God and with people. Now, that is important. People of the world are going to wonder, why are you so blessed? Why have you achieved what you have achieved? You have learned something they didn't learn because they didn't go to church. They got there through lying, stealing, and cheating. You got there because of the favor of God. Now you got to learn this because, see, you are questioning what you don't know. You are questioning your salvation if you don't know you're saved. But you got to come into the knowledge of the truth. And once you come into the knowledge of the truth, it's going to change your atmosphere. It's going to change your attitude. It's going to really change you. Now let's get into this. Notice that next bullet there. This is the key right there. The Lord shall build up Zion. Zion is the church. We are the body of Christ. God will build up the church. You are God's people. Your body is the temple of God. The first thing God's going to do when you get saved, he's going to work on building you up in his word, because the word of God brings you into the favor of God. Listen to me, St. Peter. The word of God brings you into the favor of God. You're like that. When your children obey your commands, they get favor with you. When we follow through with God's command, it brings us into the favor of God. God does not reward rebellion. No, when you obey, he said, if you're willing and obedient, you'll have the favor of God. I am willing to do whatever he say do, because I know that brings me favor. Do you want the favor of God? Yes. Whatever he say do. Yes. Now, this is what you got to learn. Hear the Bible say, the Lord shall build up Zion. This is what Paul said to the church at Acts. I mean, Peter wrote this. And now I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you an inheritance amongst all them that are sanctified. So now Peter is preaching, Paul is preaching this message, and Paul told him, he said, I commend you to God. That's the key word. Acts 20, 32, he said, I commend you to God and the word of his grace, which is able to build you up. And notice what happened when you are built up in his word. It gives you an inheritance. And the Lord shall build up Zion. The Lord shall build up the church. The Lord shall build you up. And here's Paul talking. And he said, now, brothers, I'm leaving, but I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up. Because this word's going to qualify you for favor. Amen. This word's going to bring influence into your life. Amen. That's why when you get, this is what he told the church of Colossians in Colossians 2:6. He said, as you have received Christ Jesus the Lord, walk ye in him. Verse 7, he said, rooted up and built up in him, established in the faith. The first thing you ought to do when you get saved, you got to get rooted and grounded in the word. Why? Because the word will build you up and qualify you for what's going to happen later. If you get saved and don't learn this simple basic truth and don't become a student of the word, you build your relationship on emotions. And emotions are very unstable. But this word has to be engrafted into your spirit. You have to become a student of God's word. Amen. One reason why we don't see more miracles, more favor, and more influence, people got saved, but they didn't learn what you're learning. Amen. Your first responsibility is to become a doer of his word. Amen. He said, this word will build you up. This word will give you an inheritance as you get established in God's word, rooted in this word, build up in this word. When God is satisfied, notice I said, when God is satisfied that you have taken the time to build your life on the word of God, when God is satisfied that you have taken the time to build this ministry on the word of God, when God is satisfied that you have taken the time to build your business on the word of God, your marriage, whatever you build, build it on the word of God. And then the Bible tells us in Hebrews 3:6, he that buildeth all things is God. How do God build? He built through his word. Psalms 127:1, except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. Now you can build without God, but you can't stand the storms of life that comes against it. Because the storm, remember what Jesus said in Matthew 7:24, he that hears my word and doeth this is like a wise man that built this house upon the rock. That rock is the revealed knowledge of God's word. Didn't he say, he that hears my word and doeth this not is like the man that built this house upon the sand? Notice the same attacks came whether you build on the word or whether you didn't. He said the winds of adversity blew, the storms came. Both men received the same attacks, but one stood and the other didn't. When water comes, sand goes. You ever been on the beach? Try to build a beach house and the floods came in? So God said, you first must build your marriage, build your church, build your life, build your business up on the word of God, that when the storms or the winds of adversity begin to blow against you, you'll be just like the palm tree. It may lay you down, but you're coming back up. And here he said, the Lord shall build up Zion. Tell your neighbor, he's talking about me. We got to get built up in the word of God. I want you to learn this, St. Peter's, because that's how God measures my growth, based upon how I respond to his word. Now let's move on in to the New Testament. There, notice there in Colossians, the 3rd chapter, verses 1. Here is Paul now writing to the Colossian church. He said, if you didn't be risen with Christ, he said, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth upon the right hand of God. Notice what he stated. Number two, set your affections on things above and not on things on the earth. Verse 3, for you are dead to the world, and your life is hid with Christ in God. Notice what happened. You're hiding yourself in Christ. The enemy, see, when you get into the word, you are hiding yourself in Christ. For the enemy to come at you, he got to come through Christ. Because, see, when you get in the word, that word becomes your covering. And you can boldly say that no weapon that's formed against you will prosper, and every tongue that rises against you in judgment is condemned. Don't build your house on your talent. Don't build your house on your gifts. Don't build your house on who you know. But build your house on the word of the living God. Talents come and talents go. Build it on the word. Tell your neighbor, build your life on the word. And then notice what he stated in verse 3. When Christ, who is our life, right there, Stakia. See, when you build on the word, this becomes your life. I repeat, when you build on the word, this becomes your life. So many people want God to reward what they're doing, but they're not building on the word. They're building on their gifts and talent. Man, those things, the world have gifts and talent, but they don't have Christ. So here he says, when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, notice what he happened, then shall you appear with him where? In glory. So we're learning something right here. Let's look at this. I'll pull three things out again there. The first thing he said, if you are risen with Christ, he said the first thing you ought to do when you get saved, seek those things which are above. Notice he's taking you out of the earth. He said, change your focus. Before Christ, you were the center of life. And everything was all about you. But now, he said, turn your focus to things above. What he is saying, if you are saved, after salvation, your attention, your focus should be a relationship with Christ. Remember, Matthew 6:33 said, seek ye first. That's the first thing you do. The kingdom of God, God's way of doing things, and his righteousness. And he said, I give you houses that you didn't build, wells that you didn't dig. He said, I'll fill your house up, and you'll wonder how it happened. He said, I'll fill your bank account up. Because he did say, it's the Lord thy God that gives you power to get wealth. He said, I will give you the ability and power to get wealth. You had nothing to do with it. He just gave you favor, and it just started coming your way. But see, what you got to learn, this is what you got to learn, is this. He said, I give you power to get wealth, to establish my covenant. Your money has a purpose. And your number one purpose for your money is to establish his covenant. Now, if you don't learn that one thing, that God said, I give you power to get wealth, to establish my covenant. Now, if you get money and don't know the purpose, and you want God to reward you for not fulfilling his purpose, he said, the first thing you ought to do is put God first. How do I put God first? I give God that holy tithe, because that's building his house. I give him an offer for my house. He said, I give you power to get wealth to establish my covenant. You better learn that your number one purpose for money is to build God's house. And he said, if you take care of my house, I'll take care of your house. Help us, Lord. those things above. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. That's a God of purpose. I could turn that down, but I'll leave you alone for a minute. And then notice the next thing, what he said in verse number 2. See, the set time of favor has come. He said there in verse 2, he says, set your affections on things above and not on things on the earth. Again, see, when you set something, that means you put it back in its proper place. See, you got came into this world, you got exposed to the work of the flesh and sin and people who didn't know God, and it removed your attention or your affection from God, and the world became your joy. The world became your thrill. The world became your driving force. He said, now that you're saved, he said, now put your affection back up on heaven. Set your affections upon God. Not on the earth. He said, leave the earth. Says your focus is heavenly things. Now this is what we got to learn right here, and there's so much more. I'll probably cover more Wednesday night. See, Satan competes with God for your affection, and he does it through the works of the flesh. He's forever trying to find that one particular person, place, or thing that will appeal to your flesh that you walk away from God for. He don't care what it is. He don't care who it is. Anything that you would turn your attention away from God for, that's what he looks for. Because once you do that, it becomes your God. And see, God's a jealous God. He is a very jealous God. He said, you should have no other God before me. He said, I am a jealous God. Now, God will use spiritual things, which is the work of the Spirit, to appeal to your spirit, and you are caught betwixt too, and you got to choose. Do I set? See, it's a loving relationship. That's what it comes down to. It's a loving relationship. Affection is a love affair. It's a love affair. That's what it comes down to. It's a love affair. God wants you to love him with all of your heart. Love him. John, with all of your soul. Love him. Love him, love him. He wants your love. He wants your affection. He wants you to enjoy coming to church. Enjoy doing the things of God. Enjoy. He said, don't put the people of the world or things of the world above what I called you for. Set your affection on things above and not on things upon the earth. Satan knows that if he can get you to focus up on the earth, I take you from God. You come back from heaven and you come down here in the earth and you start pecking like chicken. Always looking down for something. He said, no, raise your head up. Say, your blessings come from above. Tell your neighbor, raise your head up. David said, I'll look unto the hills for which cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord. Psalms 121. I can see why you're saying, because you can't see nothing, you keep looking down. That's all a chicken do. Man, you better start soaring like the eagle. Like the eagle, get high. Ride high, look high, because there's something God wants to do in your life, but it won't happen until you change your affections. Tell your neighbors, say, fall in love with Jesus. Tell y'all the friends, all on the other side, say, fall in love with Jesus. The set time of God's favor has come. And then notice that next bullet he said, you shall appear with him where? In glory. Now it's amazing here in Psalms 102, verse number 16, he said, the Lord shall build up Zion, he shall appear in his glory. Now Paul is telling the church, say, you shall appear with him in his glory. See, now we have been invited into a relationship with God that now we're living with him in glory. Because that's where the word takes you, into a bond. It takes you into a fellowship with God. You and God becomes one. Now he said, you will appear in his glory. Everything God has for you comes out of glory. My God shall supply all of your needs according to his riches where? In glory. We're now living in glory. All of our needs are met as we focus on building ourselves up in God. And see, in the glory realm, all you do is ask and give thanks. In the flesh realm, you beg and you plead. But when you have, when you're living with God in glory, with Christ in glory, you know you have all things. Because the Bible says he's given us all things that pertain to life and godliness. You know it through the knowledge of him who has called us into glory and virtue. When you got saved, God called you into that glory arena. And how do you get there? Through the word of God. The word puts you in a position with God. All you have to do is ask. And believe that you receive. Are you out there? There's a character that I'm going to use that everybody know about. His name is Daniel. Notice there in Daniel, the first chapter, verse number 9. Now, God had brought Daniel into favor and tender love with the prince of the eunuch. Now, let's eunuch, look at this. Let's look at this right here. See, Daniel was a native. He was a foreigner. And his people was hated by the Babylonian people. He was in a strange land. He was in a foreign land. There was, naturally, there was no reason for Daniel to walk in favor, but yet he did. He walked in the favor of God. Enemies, people hated him and his people, but yet God said he'll make your enemies your footstool when you follow his plans for your life. There'll be people blessing you, and they won't know why. You'll have God have somebody in the boardroom representing you, and they'll be speaking for you, and you won't know why. They don't know why they're favoring you, but God has given you influence. You just walk through the air, and you just smile at them. How you doing, sir? And they begin to like you. People will call you and say, I don't know, Jeff, why I'm calling you, but I heard that you are in the realtor business, and you got a house. I don't know, Gwen, why I'm calling you, but I know you got, you're in the realtor business and you got a house that I want to buy. See, favor comes in many different packages. Favor comes in many different packages. But I can assure you one thing, favor always have a blessing tied to it. Favor will bring you influence. Favor will bring you influence. Favor of God will bring you into great influence, and things will begin to happen in your life that you know you had nothing to do with it, but for some reason, somehow, you got the job that everybody else wanted. You don't know how you got the job, but you got the job that everybody else wanted. There were some people that were smarter than you, but you got the job. There were some people that didn't like you, but you got the job. There were some people that did evil against you, but you got the job. That's what the favor of God would do for you. Have a seat. Daniel walked in there. He had no earthly reason to have the favor of God in a strange country, in a strange land, around people that didn't like him. But the Bible says, if God is for you, who can be against you? For greater is he that is in you and he that is in the world. I'm on the Lord's side. And because I'm on the Lord's side, no weapon that's formed against me will prosper. And every tongue that rises against me in judgment, it is condemned. Tell your neighbor, I'm on the Lord's side. Look at somebody else and say, I'm on the Lord's side. I'm going to prove myself to God that I'll stand for what is right. 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 I'm on the Lord's side. I'm on the Lord's side. Tell your neighbor, I'm on the Lord's side. I'm on the Lord's side. I'm on the Lord's side. I'll stand for what is right. I'll speak for what is right. I'll do what is right. I will always favor the righteous. I will always favor the righteous cause. So let's take this thing to another level. The question we all must ask, why did Daniel have such favor in a strange land, a foreigner hated by the people? Why did he? I thought you would ask that question. So there, let's look at it. Number one, he had favor flowing from his spirit. Number two, he expected good things to happen. Number three, he had a healthy attitude to watch others regardless of his surroundings. Number four, he did not allow his adverse circumstances to turn sour on him. Number five, he had a sense of success flowing from him. Number six, he knew deep inside that he was linked with the Lord, and if the Lord was for him, who could be against him? Number seven, he had an authority that God had given him because of a relationship. Number eight, he walked in strength and victory, trusting God. He was rejoicing. He was so excited that he couldn't get down. And number nine, the spirit of favor flowed out of him like rivers of living water. Number 10, he was automatic. It was his life. God gave him an authority. It was in him. He believed in the Lord. And number 11, he lived excited about life and God. He didn't have a doom and gloom countenance. He didn't have a doom and gloom spirit. He knew that God was with him. He knew that God is for him. He knew the Lord was on his side. Number 12, defeat and captivity of his people did not cause him to become discouraged, because he knew in the end the Lord has never lost a battle. He knew if God was with him, God would see him through. And number 13, it challenged him to prove God on the different circumstances. And sometimes you'll find yourself in situations, but if God is for you, who can be against you? And number 14, things in the natural look bad, but Daniel knew that the Spirit of the Lord controlled every situation. And then number 15, he determined to be successful by living in a spirit of favor and success. And we should all have that same attitude. Everything I touch will turn into gold. Everything, every step I make is going to be a great step. I'm destined for greatness because I'm on the Lord's side. I represent God. God will give me favor, and I get the jobs other people hope to get because I have the favor of God. I go places other people hope to go. My business will prosper. My church will prosper. My life will prosper. My grandchildren will prosper. My children will prosper. St. Peter's will prosper. Everything about me will prosper because I'm doing what God commands me to do. I'm not hoping for it, tell your neighbor. We're not hoping for favor. We got it. Say, I'm not hoping for nothing. I got it. Good God Almighty, I got it. I got it. I got it. I got the favor of God. I got the favor of God. I got the favor of God. I got it. I got it. I got it. I got it. I got the favor of God. Yes. Yeah, tell your neighbor, I got it, I got it, I got it. I got the favor of God. I got it, I got it, I got it. I can't help it. I got it, I got it, I got it. I got the favor of God. We're not trying to get it. Tell them, I'm not trying to get it. I got it. Have a seat. Hey, favor! What's happening out there? Let me, I did some studying on this right here. I'm going to talk about toxic thoughts, which is your greatest enemy to the favor of God, to the glory of God. It's toxic thoughts. I got this information out of one of Brother Copeland's magazines. I was reading and studying. The Lord led me to write it, put it in here. It's by Dr. Carolyn Leaf. This is Dr. Carolyn Leaf is a cognitive neuroscience with a PhD in communication pathology, specializing in neuropsychology. She studied the brain, the mind. And these, the question we all must ask, what are toxic thoughts? And how are they different from healthy thoughts? And next bullet, toxic thoughts are thoughts that trigger negative and anxious emotions. Your greatest enemy. These thoughts are stored in your mind as well as in your cells, in your body. And there are 12 areas of toxic thinking, also called the dirty dozen. Let's look at them. You want to learn this right here, guys. Because if you're going to walk in the favor of God, you got to deal with your thought life. Number one, toxic thoughts. Number two, toxic emotions. Number three, toxic words. Number four, toxic choices. Number five, toxic dreams. Number six, toxic seeds. Number seven, toxic faith. Number eight, toxic love. Number nine, toxic touch. Number 10, toxic seriousness. Number 11, toxic health. And number 12, toxic schedules. There's several other things she said about this. Number one, she said, thoughts are active and they grow and changes situations. Number two, she said, thoughts influence every decision, word, action, and physical reaction we make. You can trace them back to the way you think. And number three, every time you have a thought, it is actually changing your brain and your body for better or worse. Toxic thoughts are like poison. They affect people in all stages of life, in every part of the world, every day. Even God said it, as a man thinketh. Proverbs 23:7. Your thoughts, if I knew the dominant thoughts in your life, I can tell you what your future holds. Now you can reverse the effect of toxic thoughts through the word of God. That's because he says, set your affection on things above and not on things on the earth. If you're risen with Christ, seek those things above where Christ sitteth upon the right hand of God. Notice what the Bible stated there in Isaiah 55, verses number 6, 9. Seek ye the Lord while he might be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. Verse 7, he said, let the wicked man, the wicked woman, forsake his or her ways. And the unrighteous man or the unrighteous woman, his or her thoughts. Let him or her return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon him or her. Notice what God stated there in verse 8. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. So once you get saved, you have to reprogram your mind. You have to reprogram your thoughts, because God said, my thoughts are different from your thoughts. If you have been risen with Christ, seek those things which are above and not on things on the earth, where Christ sits on the right hand of God. Set your affections on things above and not on the earth. And here is God saying, my ways of my thoughts is not like yours. Your ways of your thoughts is earthly, fleshly. But God said, no, not my ways. So once I get saved, I have to get into the Bible and reprogram my mind to think like God thinks. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, Philippians 2:5. Romans 12:2, be not conformed to the world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you might prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Romans 14:5, let every man be persuaded in his own mind. I will keep them in perfect peace whose mind. So if you get saved and you don't reprogram your mind to think like God think, you will continue to think and talk like the people of the world trying to get heavenly things. And you can't get heavenly things living in the earth. Now, the Bible says in Ephesians 2:5, we are seated with Christ in heavenly places. God has positioned you in Christ, but your problem is those toxic thoughts. Those thoughts keep you in the earth. You're eating the fruit of your thoughts. Your words identify your thoughts. Your actions identify your thoughts. We got to do something with those toxic thoughts. Changing your ways, changing your thoughts, thinking like God, moving like God. Now, the minute you start thinking like God, talking like God, people will take an offense. Because they won't call you no more. Because, see, their conversation is built around the flesh, and your conversation is built around the spirit. Now, they won't call you no more and say, I don't like the way she talks. You either have it working in you, the works of the flesh or the works of the spirit. They don't agree. And I can tell you, Jesus said, when you start walking out this truth, you're going to offend some people. Some people are just going to take an offense when you start taking standing for the truth. Who does she think she is? She thinks she's better than us. No, I'm just walking out what I've been taught. And he's so arrogant. It's not arrogant. It's confidence. Because I know if I'm on the Lord's side, can't nobody stop me. And I laugh in the face of the devil. He thinks he's plotting against me, but he can't stop me. That's what Job 5:22 said, in famine and destruction. He said, man, I will laugh because I know in the end I'm going to come out on top if I do what's right. See, you're going to need favor in this life. Here's my two grandsons. I love it. I love my grandkids. I got nine of them. Here's two of them. And I was praying for these boys back here. Now, you mark my word. I told these boys. I say, boys, what do you want in life? This is Justin and Jared. I got nine grandkids. Now, you mark this down. I say, don't y'all take offense to what I'm getting ready to say. I say, you better not never come in my office wearing a dress. I'm establishing order in my life, in my family. And you know what they told me? Papa, you don't have to worry about that. Then I asked them next, I said, now, boys, how many kids do you want? Each one of them said, we want three kids. Justin wants two boys first and a girl. Jared wants a boy, a girl, and a boy. Now, you mark my word. You write it on paper. Yeah. I'm the patriarch over this family. Yeah. I spoke into their life. Hallelujah. I came in an agreement with it. Write it on paper. He will have two boys and a girl. He will have a boy and a girl and another boy. Yeah. Now you mark my word. And guess what? I want you to do the same thing to your children. Pronounce the favor of God on their life. Do it with your grandkids. You hear me? Bring them in. Bring your kids into your house. Set them down and prophesy to them and come in an agreement with them. They will prosper. They will prosper. Their favor will follow these boys everywhere they go, and they will represent God in high places. And you will mark me there. Write it on paper. And when it happens, you're going to say, the bishop said it. And they'll walk in places not because of who they are, but whose they are. We establish some order for their life. Now, I told them, stay in school, get your education, because that's going to qualify you for some things that other people that didn't get an education won't get. They want it, but they can't get there. Speak to your grandchildren. Prophesy over your children. I'll prophesy over this church. Now, you just take what I say. The best days are yet to come. Our best days are yet to come. Our best days are yet to come. People are going to run down this house. They're going to run here because they know the life of God is in this house. Your best days are yet to come. 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 The best days are, we've had some good days here at St. Peter, but the best is yet to come. You take your walk with God serious. You don't tip and dip and slip. Or you take your walk with God serious. Because God will take you places you never dreamed of going. God will make things happen that you can't make happen. God will open up doors that no man can close. You prophesy to your grandchildren. Prophesy if your children out of the will of God, you take their position. Have a seat. Bring them in your office. Set them down. That's a little, that ain't part of my message, but. Set some order. Tell your neighbor, set some order in your house. Set some order with your children. Set some order with your grandchildren. just happened out there? Tell your neighbor, I'm walking in the favor of God. Favor! 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 So you got to start calling those things which be not as though they were. If God say the righteous shall rejoice with favor, we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. You got to start rejoicing right where you are. You know, I'm like this. This is my style. Exhalated joys. When I want to get something in my spirit, I find a tape or some music or something that relate to it, and I say it over. Ask my lady. She think I get tired of it. I just let it keep rehearsing it. It follows me everywhere I go, because I told my wife I want to get it in my spirit. See, the Lord has put upon my heart to have a healing crusade here in this church. Yeah, the Lord has put on my heart to have a mass healing crusade, to have a mass baptism crusade, to have a mass deliverance crusade right here at St. Peter. And see, right now, my first is going to be a mass healing crusade. But see, all I'm listening to now is healing scripture, healing record. I'm getting this thing down in my spirit. And when the Lord tell me I'm going to fast 3 days and come in here and preach and drive out some devils. You got to get it in your spirit. You have to become one and with it. Your best days are yet to come. Tell your neighbor, your best days are yet to come. But you got to line up with the Word. You got to line up with God. Ask your neighbor, say, whose side are you on? Say, I'm on the Lord's side. I'm on the Lord's side. See, once you reprogram your mind, program your thoughts, you think like God, you talk like God, you believe like God, and you know you're going to job knowing that you're walking in the favor of God. That's what happened to Daniel. In the natural, it was impossible, but Daniel had favor flowing through his spirit, and they were promoting. The same thing happened to Joseph. Joseph had many trials, but God at 17 years old told him what's going to happen. And Joseph just walked out every trial because he knew in due season everything God said would come to pass. And at the age of after 17 years going through trials, God gave him some influence that he became the second in command. He wasn't supposed to be that, because the wife lied on him about a lustful act. The jealous lied on him. So many people lied on him. But Joseph never did take an offense. Yes. Hear me, James? Joseph never did take an offense. Don't get in the flesh and abort your destiny. Stay with God. Get on the Lord's side. Line up with God, because God's going to make things happen, John. God's going to make things happen. Oh! God's going to make things happen. 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 Yeah, God's going to make things happen. Tell your neighbor, God's going to make things happen. God's going to make things happen. God's going to make things happen. And you know that the Lord has did it. Everybody's going to know that it's the Lord's doing. And it's marvelous within His sight. Your friend's going to know it. Your family's going to know it. John, everybody's going to know that the Lord is on your side. Just reprogram your mind. Reprogram your thoughts. Get rid of them toxic thoughts. You're not poor. You're not broke. You're not by yourself. We are rich. We are blessed. We are walking in the fullness of God. And the days of burden making, they're over. Why? Because we're walking in the favor of God. Tell your neighbor, God's going to make things happen for me. God's going to make things happen for St. Peter's. God's going to make things happen for you. It's not because of you. It's because of your relationship with the one that gives that favor. Have a seat, please. Let me close this out. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Hey, favor, what's happening out there? Notice what David said about God there in Psalms 139, verse 17 and 8. He said, how precious also are their thoughts unto me. Oh God, he said, how great is the sum total of the thoughts that you think about me. That's the way we think. God is always increase-minded. He said in the Psalms 115, God is on, you're on God's mind. He's trying to find ways to bring blessings and rewards to your house. And that's the way you think. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be exceedingly glad. This is the day of favor. Every step I take is a step into favor. People will favor me that don't know me, but they'll favor me because I'm on the Lord's side. There's something about my personality that draws favor. My words draws favor. My personality draws favor. My looks. My looks. My looks. Come here, son. You notice how these boys look? Look at them. Look at them. When somebody look at these boys, they're going to say, those boys came from some good stock. See their looks. Tell your neighbor, your looks. Look at them, say, your looks will draw favor. Look at somebody, say, your looks will draw favor. When people look at you, they're going to say, that boy, that girl came from some good stock. When they hear you talk, he came from some good stock. When they see the blessing and see what? See, God's taking these boys places they never dreamed of. Mark my word, they never dreamed. They have no idea because the Bible says, eyes haven't seen, ears haven't heard, neither has entered the heart of man of things that God has prepared for them that love him. But he revealed those things unto us by his Spirit. I got some more grandsons. There's little Rick. There's Jake. There's Hampton. That's JJ. Got some granddaughters. And AJ Jr., he's my great grandson. Granddaughters, Alex, Paige, Isabella, my grandkids. Destined for greatness. Destined for greatness. Destined for greatness. And I want you to prophesy to your children and tell them you're destined for greatness. Don't settle for less when you can have God's best. Don't settle in for a little bit when you can get all that God has for you. Destined for greatness. Just speak to your children. St. Peter's, you have no idea. Oh, it's on the threshold right here. Right here. God gave us this building for a purpose. Right here. On these grounds. On these grounds. On these grounds. What's on the threshold of heaven? You almost walked away from here because you didn't know the Lord. But you better be glad you stayed. Tell your neighbor, you're going to be glad you stayed. Look at him, say, you're going to be glad you stayed. You almost walked away from what God has started. Look at him, say, you're going to be glad you stayed. Notice what David stated in verse 18. He said in verse 18, he said, if I should count them, he said, the thoughts you have to watch me, they are more than can be numbered than the sands on the sea. He said, the good thoughts that God has towards us, it's more than can be numbered. He said, when I awake, this is the key, God's going to awaken you to who you are. He's awakening you to what he has prepared for you. I believe you are being awakened right now. See, we are dead to the world, but we are alive to God. David said, when I awake, awaken to what? The way God think about me. That's the whole plan. When we awaken to the way God think, let this mind
when I awake, when we awake to the fact that God is thinking about good things, not evil. Notice what he stated there in Jeremiah 29. He said, man, I know the thoughts that I think toward you, said the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not evil to give you a prosperous end. This is the way God thinks. He said, I'm always thinking how I can prosper you. I'm always thinking how I can excel you. I'm always thinking, he said, my challenge is to get you to line up with me. If you study that, he said, that word peace means prosperity. Expect, he wanted to give you a prosperous end. But you got to change your thoughts and line up with his thoughts. Focus on what he said, not what they're saying on NBC, ABC, and all of these other networks. And then notice what else he said there in verse number 12, what he said, then shall you call upon me, and you shall go and pray unto me, and I will listen unto you. Verse 13, notice what he said, and you shall seek me, and you'll find me when you search for me with all of your heart. You can't casually seek God. If you don't show up in 5 minutes, you're going back. You got to stay there. Stay there, tell you. Stay there until you know that you've heard from him. And then notice in verse 14, he said, I will be found of you, said the Lord, and I will turn away your captivity. He said, I'll remove that bondage in your life. And I will gather you from all the nations that has held you in captivity and from all the places whither I have driven you, said the Lord. He said, say, that word is for me. Tell your neighbor, that word is for you. That word is for us. Reprogram your thoughts. Expect the favor of God. Renew your mind. Expect the favor of God. Program your mind to say what God says about you. And start talking to yourself. Hey, JC, what's happening? I'm walking in the favor of God. You got to encourage yourself. When you feel yourself getting down, girls and guys, encourage yourself. David said, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that's within me. Bless his holy name. Hey, favor, what's happening out there? Ask your neighbor, what's happening over your house? The set time of God's favor has come. 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 Oh, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I'm walking in the favor of God. Tell your neighbor, everybody's going to favor me. Bible says the steps of a good man is ordered by the Lord. God is ordained in your steps. Don't ever be confused because there's an adversity around you. Daniel headed around him, but he still walked in favor. Joseph headed around him. But he still had influence because he had a word from God that he would be what he turned out to be. I know you got a word from God. Favor will bring it to pass. Have a seat. If you're here this morning and you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and first and the Savior, the first step to the favor of God is becoming a believer. Because the Bible says the righteous shall rejoice. And we're made righteous through the Lord Jesus Christ. It comes on the day of salvation. Even to those of you that are online, those of you that are streaming, I'm speaking the same word to you. This could be the greatest day of your life. The day that you turn back to God. The day that you turn back to God. A day that you turn to God. We have limitations in ourselves. But if God is for us, who can be against us? Nobody can stop you. When God is for you. If you're here this morning and you have not accepted Christ as your Lord and personal Savior, that's the first step, is getting things right with God. Just lift up your hand. I will be glad to pray with you and for you. Anyone out here today, say, Bishop, I want Christ in my heart. To those of you that's online, just lift your hand to God. He sees everything. And just ask God to forgive you of your sins and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Is there anyone out here today? Oh, bless God. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Well, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Let's prepare our hearts for a $1 million offering.